In our first segment, we'll be speaking primarily with Vicky. Vicky, tell us about flat classrooms and how it evolved into the Horizon Project and then NetGenet.
Well, Julie and I actually crossed paths in the K-12 Online Conference in 2006, but my students were studying some of the trends in Tom Friedman's book, The World is Flat, as were Julie's, and I blogged it on my blog, some of the reflections that the students had shared. And Julie emailed me, and she said, you know, we're studying about this, you know, at the same time, but what would it be like if we actually experienced the flat world, this outsourcing and globalization and collaboration and all of these things? And that was when we designed the Flat Classroom Project, and we combined our classes on the other side of the world. Julie at the time was at the International School in Dhaka, Bangladesh, and, of course, I was still at Westwood. And what we found was a complete transformation in learning, not only in the deep, deep learning of our topic, which was information technology, but the deep learning of different cultures. I think the thing that really showed me this was different was that, you know, I live in a very small rural town in South Georgia, and the students, a lot of them don't travel a lot. And about 2 weeks into the project, I had several students line up at my desk, and I could tell they had something important to tell me. And they said, you know, Miss Vicky, the news media is wrong. And I said, what are you talking about? Well, they said, well, how people have characterized, you know, some people in some other countries, particularly people of Muslim faith, is not accurate. It's not true. We enjoy working with these students. They're great people, and you really have to judge people for the inside and not just for a label that's attached to them. And when that happened, and I know Julie has the same stories on her side of the world, I realized that it was a lot more than just teaching my content, that it was about broadening the worldview for the students and just the amazing transformation. And so we went from that, and we were worn out, but we started emailing each other again in January when we were done and said, you know, we really want to do this again because this is addictive. We have to do it. And we have all these other people that want to do it as well. And so we started the Horizon Project based on the Horizon Report from the New Media Consortium and EDUCALLS, and had about 7 schools involved, and it grew, you know, a little over 100 students. And then we again did Flat Classroom the next October. But we added something for the younger grade levels called DigiTeen, which talks about digital citizenship. And we again did Horizon, and then now Flat Classroom and DigiTeen each run 3 times a year. We have lead teachers, Ann Murchison, Steve Madsen, Barbara Stefanik. I mean, I could name 20 or 30 teachers that have really made up the core of what we call Flat Classroom projects. And then Horizon morphed into the NetGen Ed project with Don Tapscott. And he actually called us and said, you know, we have these, you know, I have this new book. I would like to interact with the students. I really like this flat classroom model of teaching. And so it's just kind of evolved into something that Julie and I are trying to figure out how to keep a handle on now, working on making it a nonprofit and trying to keep these projects going and the teachers engaged. And just improve the pedagogy, and also we've involved a lot of researchers and opened up the classrooms for research in terms of what we're seeing.
Well, that's awesome and a terrific segue to the next slide that I have here, which is basically about Tom Friedman. How did he become aware of your work and ultimately get involved, and how, in your opinion, has his involvement changed the project?
Well, he actually, I believe about a month and a half into it, Julie, if you want to jump in here, he actually emailed Julie. Julie, was it about, a month and a half into the project?
Yeah, it was towards the end of it, actually, and he emailed because he'd read on my blog about the project, so he made contact. And then we developed this sort of rapport, and Tom basically came back to us after the project finished in the new year. He came back to us and said, well, look, I'm rewriting my book. I'd like to put a section, I'm doing a section about people who are out there doing it, like you two are, and can we collaborate on a section in the book? So we did. We collaborated with Tom on this couple of pages in his book, which was a great experience and a real opportunity for us to get a perspective on what Tom was really doing in that book.
So how do you think it's changed the project, having him directly involved?
Well, really, both he and Don Tapscott being involved, you know, obviously Tom Friedman, you know, writing about it, and then ISTE giving us the, we applied for the Online Learning Award. Winning that, you know, increased the visibility. But really what it did was it brought out a lot of teachers who are very hungry to connect with other classrooms and other teachers in this way. And so we've seen, you know, a lot of email coming from the book. A lot of people say, you know, I picked up the book and now I'm finally to page 512. And, you know, how can we be involved? And so we're starting to get a lot of email from the book, you know, in that way. And, you know, I think the biggest transformation, though, has happened with the interaction with Don Tapscott recently, because he actually forum posted and interacted with the students. And it's just really a great new way of communicating. I know Carl Fish did it also with his Pink project. So, you know, there are a lot of great ways to interact with authors. Now, the wonderful thing is it no longer has to be one author with one classroom. It can be an author, as it was in this case, with 350 students or thousands of students. I know that Yes I Can Science in Canada is making it possible for students all around the world to communicate and blog with astronauts on the space station. So this flattening is about, you know, connecting in ways we've never been able to do before, one to many, many to many, just in so many ways. And it's really a grassroots effort of teachers that we sort of, you know, represent part of that movement that's happening on a broader scale.
Excellent. So I know I've been following you guys for, seems like forever, on Twitter and reading your blogs, and I actually remember when you reacted to Tom finding, contacting you and getting started. And so I've been following you since then. How has, obviously you've done this now many times and you have a lot of experience, 20 different countries, over 1,000 kids. How, in your opinion, does flat classroom pedagogy change the classroom dynamic?
Well, this is something I'm absolutely passionate about. I have three children of my own. Two of them have learning differences. I like to call them differences because about a third of gifted kids do have learning differences. And what this sort of learning, it's very involved with project-based learning, genuine assessment, differentiated instruction. It's important for students to know that they have a choice, but also authentic research. When you do a project like this that the students cannot copy and paste out of Wikipedia. They literally have to create new, authentic research. It takes it to a higher level because you're really looking at the thinking skills that students have instead of, you know, oh, can they regurgitate to me something they can read in 1,000 books? They're literally writing something that people have not really looked at that way before. We like to mash up authors. We've mashed up Tom Friedman with Dan Pink. We've mashed up the Horizon Report this year with Don Tapscott's 8 Net Gen Norms, which it's a great book, Grown Up Digital. And so pushing students to do authentic research, it's such a challenge for the students, but it's also, you know, it's a challenge for the teachers because sometimes the teachers say, well, you know, I can't find this in a book. How am I going to teach this? And it's like, you don't. You teach the students. You're the coach. Where do I find this? How do I validate my research? How do I link? How do I draw my own conclusions? Totally different method of teaching. A lot of oral quizzes so that the students are sharing information. But we literally require the students to have partners that they will never see. If they have partners at their same school, we like them to be in a different class. So they literally can't look face to face because we want them to be ready to collaborate like so many of us have to now in the educational world and in the business world.